And here's some examples of premium plugins for WordPress. So WooCommerce is a big one, you can use downloads, user forms, WP job manager, Melbourne for WordPress. These are just a few, there are really hundreds of plugins like this. But the first sort of premium product that stands out in my mind is Sparkle. You might remember it, before it was very popular on Facebook. And that's an example of a premium game where it was completely free to play, but if you wanted to do better at it, to have more features, you would pay. And then the same thing with the App Store. This is today, like, these are the top 10 grossing apps on the App Store. So these are the ones that make the most money. And you'll notice that every single one of them is pretty much free. Because people want to spend money when they're getting the main product for free. Even South Park TV show has talked about premium before. So they actually did a whole episode about a year ago called Freemium because it's free, where they talked about this concept of freemium products. So why does freemium work? Like, what's the value in it? What are the benefits of it? Why is it good both for us, people making the products, and for users of those products? Well, firstly, everyone has access. So what's really nice about freemium products is that the core product is free. And this is really similar to WordPress, where the goal of WordPress is to democratize publishing by giving everyone access to the platform. So by giving away that core product or plugin or your thing for free, developers actually democratizing the industry that they're in. So WooCommerce is an example of something that's democratizing e-commerce. And Interfolks, like we spoke about before, is democratizing the ability to have a contact form on your site. And the nice thing also about premium products is that communities form around them. Instead of just having 100 or 200 paying customers, you may have 2 or 3,000 or maybe 20 or 30,000 free users. But those free users, because you have so many of them, they create a community where they help each other, they fix the plugin, if there's a problem with the theme or the plugin, they'll report the bugs and fix it. So you have a whole community of people doing the work for you for free. And free distribution and publishing. So it's really, really easy to advertise a product that's free. Especially with WordPress, you have the ability to add your plugin or your theme to WordPress.org. And then every single WordPress site in the entire world can see your product completely for free. And then, you know, through that, you can link them to your premium add-ons. And of course, with publicity, people like to write about these free products. They get a lot more exposure because when your website like WP Tavern writing about a WordPress plugin, it's nice to be able to write about something that everyone, all of your readers can use for free. So how does this model work? Like, how do you actually create a free product? There's a few different ways. The first approach you can take is by having a simple plugin, like a core plugin for free, and then you sell the premium version of the plugin. So you have the free one, premium one, and the free one has a lot of features, but the premium one has extra features. So it's just two products, one free, one premium. This is an example that MailChimp for WordPress, a friend of mine, runs this plugin, Daniel included. So with this plugin, you've got a free version on WordPress.org that has over a million, maybe a million and a half downloads. But then he also has a pro version, which people that want those few extra features come to his site and purchase. Another way is doing it with a core plugin that's free, that actually has all the features, but then having support updates as paid upgrades. So people might go to your site to purchase an hour of support with you or automatic updates. This is less popular, it's not the approach I like to take, but it is something that has been done by a lot of people. Then the most popular way is definitely to have a core plugin that's completely free, or WordPress.org, or core free, thing that's free on WordPress.org. And then you offer add-ons that give extra functionality. And the nice thing about this is you're not limited to having one premium version or support that you're selling, but you could be selling hundreds. Like in WooCommerce, we have, I think, 400 or 500 different premium add-ons available on WooThemes.com. So this is definitely the most popular approach. It's the one I'm going to really talk about a lot today because I've seen it work and I have most experience with it. There are quite a few plugins doing this. WooCommerce, individual downloads, individual forms, these are just a few. There are hundreds doing the exact same thing. And yeah, like this is just something that I'm really like a fan of doing if you're going to take that approach with premium. So I thought we'd be talking about that today. So what is an add-on? What makes it something that doesn't go into the free version of the plugin? Well, normally like when you release an additional plugin, you put the additional features that don't fit into the core one into the add-on. But how do you decide what goes into the add-on? What like makes the cut into the core? And what goes into the add-on? I like to take the WordPress philosophy and apply the 80/20 rule. So 80% of users might want a feature, then I want to put that in the core product for free. But if it's something that only 20% or less, the 10% of your users need, I think you could get away with making that an add-on that costs extra. So really just satisfying the majority of your users, to me is really important, and is what I try to focus on when I decide
what goes into
an add-on. And back to that South Park before, they talk about the same thing, where 80-90% of the users will not spend any money, but then there's that 5-10% that are happy to. So with WooCommerce, taxes are a really important part of any e-commerce site. Definitely 80%, 90%, maybe every single user needs those taxes built into the core plugin. So that should definitely be free and included with the core plugin. But then subscriptions is a feature that not really every single WooCommerce store is going to need. Maybe 5 or 10% I want it. So this should be more appropriate as an add-on, and it's something that needs add-on. So with feature forms, the forms plugin, managing form entries, I think you in your WordPress admin, all the entries that people have made, the form. That's pretty essential. I think a lot of people are going to need that. So it makes more sense as a form plugin. But then PayPal payments, that would make more sense in add-on because it's something that not everyone needs. And also with like PayPal payments, the user of your plugin is making money from it. So they're going to be happy to spend their extra money on add-on. So we got 80/20 plugins. 80% of users need it, but 20% don't. So that could be an add-on. What else? Integrations is a big one. So add-ons for your plugin and integrating other services. With WooCommerce, we've got one for Stripe, Slack, USPS. So these are just a few examples of integrations you could do. And also add-ons that make the user money. This is a really big thing. Because if the user of the add-on is going to make money from the add-on, they're going to be happy to spend a little bit of money in purchasing it up here. If in the long run, they're going to make a lot more than what it costs to buy. So I mentioned community a little bit earlier. That's something I want to explore. Community is really, really important when you take the freemium approach. Community is really crucial. It's probably the most important thing to consider when you're building a freemium plugin. And you really do need like a strong, involved community. They're going to end up believing in what they're doing, they're going to support it,
going to write documentation about it, write guides about it, review it. Like the community is the core of having a successful freemium plugin. And we already have a head start with WordPress because it's 100% GPL and open source, so it's a lot easier to get the community involved. And I'm not making this up. So with WooCommerce, we have a community on Facebook with, I think, over 4,000 people now, which is about the size of the WordPress before community, which is nice. And this is a community of people that help themselves. There's a lot of us that work for WooCommerce, for Automattic, that are in that group. But really, we don't get involved. The community does a lot of the work. So someone from the community will ask a question, and someone from the community will answer it. So this is completely right by itself. And also on GitHub, we have over 350 contributors to WooCommerce that fix bugs, that add features, and they're a really important part of making WooCommerce what it is today. Also, on Google, you can review WooCommerce review. And there are hundreds, if not thousands, of reviews written without any of our involvement, just people in the community writing about it, something that they're getting value from. And also guides and tutorials. And also support. This is one of the biggest things on WordPress.org. In the WooCommerce support area, we don't really do that much in there. We've got our premium support, and we do help out with bugs and stuff, but a lot of people that are just looking for support will get answers from other people in the community. And it's all run by the community. And also on Stack Overflow, which is another website people ask for support on. So it's a big thanks to like a growing passionate community. Next, it's really important to make it extendable. So making your plugin really easy to build add-ons for. Because of course you want to make it easy for yourself to build these add-ons, but you want to make it easy for the community as well. With WooCommerce, we may have 300 or 400 extensions that we sell, like add-ons that we sell up with themes.com. But there are thousands, on CodeCanyon and other websites that have been built for WooCommerce. So we don't make any money from it, so we're not involved. But it's built by the community. So if you want to make it easy for the community to build for your product. And you can do this through making developer friendly. So with WordPress, if it's a plugin, it should be full of relevant hooks, so filters and actions that other plugins can hook into. Like with WooCommerce, you can hook into when WooCommerce is loaded, so you can also have that or change the active card phrase. And also custom templates for theme developers. So there are a lot of people here I know that are building WooCommerce themes, and we'll try to make it as easy as possible for you by allowing to make theme overrides. So in your theme, you have a WooCommerce folder that takes you from the WooCommerce plugin and puts it into your theme, so you override with your own styles. If you're going to be taking this approach to the premium plugin, you want to do the exact same thing in your plugin, and all you really have to do is add some code that just basically checks. Does the current theme have a folder that is named WooCommerce or that your plugin is named that has overrides? And if it does, load them. If not, load the one from the plugin. And it's really important to give your add-ons value. You shouldn't just make them for the sake of it. They should be appealing. And users should be really happy to spend that extra money paying for an add-on feature. And how do you do that? Well, one of the ways is by actually just giving support. So having really, really good support available to people that purchase your plugin. Live chat or one day replies, that should be really important. And it's what users now expect when they purchase a premium add-on. And it gives them a reason to keep buying future add-ons anyway. Also updates, like automatic updates for themes as well, is one of the most important things. So just having that built into your add-ons or your themes, it's pretty important. And I get asked this a lot, so I thought I'd mention it. How can you actually sell your add-ons afterwards? And there's a few different ways. GoCanyon is one. I think a lot of people here might have experience with that. Personally, I've done that before as well. It's an easy way to get access to a big marketplace. But you may want to have more control over that. So by doing that, you could use WooCommerce. And WooCommerce has digital downloads built in. Then you can use a plugin like API Manager, we sell WooThemes.com. To handle the licensing and automatic updates, or there's actually a free version built by Mike Jolly, who's the developer of WooCommerce, and it's an open source one. The WP plugin licensing, and he uses it for WP.manager, still does. Just pretty much use this plugin with WooCommerce to have a update and licensing for your items. Of course, there's also easy to downloads, another option I spoke about today. They allow you to sell downloads, and they have a premium add-on, lets you sell licenses and handle updates. So, I said this before, but with these, you can do the exact same thing. So, we have one that we sell on WordPress to be available. We don't actually sell it, it's pretty free for storefront and some WordPress.org. But then we make money from selling, before I mention that, our features of storefront actually that it has no short codes, it has no styles, no page builders. It's very simple, it's very clean, very lean, it's free, and it's beautiful. So we actually make money by selling charging for it. We want people to be able to use this thing and get value out of it. We also want to say, well, if you want a different style, we do have a charging that you can purchase. We can secure charging.
And one of the
benefits
of this is, instead of just selling one copy of the premium thing, we're able to sell multiple copies of charting things. And we also sell extensions. So the cool thing about extensions is that we're supplying the same approach that the same plugins by selling add-ons for the theme.
So we have storefront extensions that add features like mega menus, reviews, pricing tables, and it's been a really successful way of
monetizing this theme.
So, I'm pretty much finished my talk now. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask now, or you can come up to me after and ask.
My name is Boris, and my question goes like, how do I encourage my clients to use WooCommerce instead of other e-commerce solutions available in the market?
It's a good idea, and a good question. Only on the other platform. Now, you need to come to this step the same way that you've been convinced to use WooCommerce. So if you ask yourself, what makes WooCommerce appealing to me? Well, in your case, it may be that it's free, and that there's a community around it. You might say, well, the other e-commerce solutions don't have that same community, or it's not completely free. And another big part is that it's built for WordPress. So if people look at other e-commerce solutions like Magento, those are good solutions, but a lot of us here in the WordPress industry, the WordPress business, we care about open source, about GPL. So if you really care about that stuff, you're going to want to use a solution built for WordPress that is open source, that's GPL, and it has that same community around it. So really, I would just try to fix your clients the same way that you piece of this.
Actually, for your blog page, I've also been working with for the past 2 years now, I guess. And so I wanted to ask you, you've written about how you tech startup first, for UFIS or something that you were. And so I wanted to know, how do we continue with WooCommerce? It's not about free, it's about WooCommerce, right? What do you see the development process for a new developer? The gradual learning curve for a new developer.
For me personally? Yeah. Or for you as a developer?
For anyone trying to develop for using WooCommerce.
Well, like in my case, when I started a year and a half ago in July last year, I started doing WooCommerce support. So, for me, really, my focus was on just answering questions for one user at a time. But I became, I think, better as a developer when I realized I was answering the same question every day, two or three times, or every week, tens of times. So I started thinking, well, I have to stop trying to answer the question of one user and answer the question of thousands of users by developing a solution, or developing an add-on that does what everyone's asking for. So, I think just looking at problems that users are having and identifying what are common problems, ones that it's not just one or two users, but hundreds or thousands, and then making a solution for that, for me that's made me a lot better developer. So I would suggest the same thing.
Hi, my name is Bryce Adams. I'm a
what I'd like to ask is, like, basically, I've already asked professionally, but now I'd like to make it formally. Like, in Nepal, it's very difficult to buy all those expensive extensions. So is there any plan of WooCommerce to making it easily available for other countries? Second is, like, I thought you were sharing coupons. Yeah. So what is that?
Coupons coming. That is difficult, especially in developing countries. People would be able to spend that amount of money on extensions. And there's a reason that they're that expensive. It's not just because Automattic or Woo wants to make a lot of money. I think it's just about figuring out what the cost of knowledge is, especially supporting people, because even though we're selling a plugin to someone in a developing country, support is still coming from wherever our team is located. So if we're paying someone a salary in America to do support, we have that cost involved. So there's a reason why the products are that expensive, but at the same time, there are plans to try make it more accessible. We've been focusing a lot on India because it is just a bigger market to test it with. And then if it works in India, we're going to apply the same approach in Nepal and other countries like Thailand, where we want to make, definitely we want to make payment gateways, other integrations with local companies completely free. So that involves us contacting the payment gateway in Nepal and talking to them and saying, well, if we make the add-on for your gateway free, it'll be great for the users in Nepal and for people running stores here, so they can get for free. We're happy because our users are happy. But then at the same time, we need something from you, like a share, a commission almost, of each user. So we're working on those solutions, but that takes a lot of time because you have to make deals with different companies in different countries. And of course, with other extensions like subscriptions where we can't make a deal to make it free, we're looking at how we can make it cheaper for countries like India and Nepal where we can make it half price or even less than that. But right now it's just about trying to figure out how well we can make it and how we can do it without ruining the business. Because we might be able to give away a copy for free to everyone, but then we've got to support hundreds of people for free, and then we can't support paying customers and no one buys them, and then all of a sudden you don't have a product anymore. Of course, today, so I do have a coupon for everyone here. If you do want to purchase anything on WooCommerce.com, WooCommerce.com, it's looking for 50% off. It's not last day though. You can use that for the next couple of months. So, I mean, hopefully that will help everyone. Don't share it to anyone outside the forum, it's just for you guys. I've been to like a lot of workouts I've spoken at, and normally we never do this, but I just like the community here, and so I sort of convinced me yesterday, so you guys. Does anyone have any other questions?
There are two ways that you could sell your plugin, like provide something for free and a premium version with extra features, and sell that as premium plugin, right? And the other feature would be like how WooCommerce is functioning, like say extensions and all. So there are those two things, but how do we decide which one is the best for us? I mean, we could use a premium one and all the features over there, maybe say for a little higher price, or maybe make 3 or 4 extensions and sell them for a lower price. So how do we decide on that, and how much is a good number to go to extensions versus and instead of just premium?
Try and like make a list of those features that fall into the categories we've spoken about before, so stuff that only 5 or 10% of users want, or integrations, or stuff that's going to make our users money. Make a list of those things and see how big it is. If it's a big list with like 20 or 30 different plugins, that will probably make more sense as a premium add-on, because you can actually spend more time on the individual features, while if you took the approach with just having one premium version, then you're going to have all those features, but they're not all going to get the same amount of attention. So some users can be angry, and then they're trying to put too much into a premium plugin. Because the same rule that we spoke about before, with the 80-20, like 20% or less of your users want money more sensitive add-ons, applies to add-ons. So with an add-on like subscriptions, it wouldn't make sense for subscriptions to have all these extra features that only 10% of subscriptions we support use. That would make more sense as an additional add-on. So it's just about figuring out what the majority of your users need and putting that into the add-on. Or
I like the example before I get developed for WordPress. I think that's a really good example of having the free version and the paid version, because there aren't too many different add-ons you can make. And I think that works really well for that. So it's also just asking yourself what you prefer to do. If you want to maintain 20 or 30 different plugins, or if you can maintain one, that's a big part of it. Thank you. Do you have any more?